The religion which discriminates between two people is partial. And the religion which treats crows of its adherents worse than dogs and criminals and inflicts upon them insufferable disabilities is no religion at all. Religion and slavery are incompatible. Cannot be a more degrading system of social organization than Chaturvarnya. It is the system which deadens, paralyzes, and cripples the people from helpful activity. For centuries, they lived like this, in perpetual penury and social slavery. They were at the bottom, a part of the Hindu social order, and yet they were forced to live away from habitation. The untouchables of India, the pariahs of Hindu society, their humiliation and degradation ordained by Mannu, the great lawgiver. There came a man who gave his life to lift them up from the darkness of millennia-old social brutality and injustice, who gave them dignity, self-respect, and a will to fight for their human rights. His decrepit ancestral home at Ambadve in coastal Kolaba district of Maharashtra and the stark locality and silent tombs of his ancestors at nearby Dapoli may have a story to tell. A story of brutal social exploitation sanctioned by religion and the sacred scripts, of miseries imposed by a perfidious and inhuman social system. Legend has it that a spiritual ancestor blessed Ramji and his wife Bhima that they will bear a son who will brighten the dark horizon of his people. The son, Bhimrao, was thus born on 14th April 1891 in the military colony of Mhow in Madhya Pradesh, his father being a Subedar Major in the Indian Army. Though an untouchable, the father was a devout admirer of the famous Saint Kabir and taught his songs to Bhimrao, who was greatly influenced by the humanistic ideals of the medieval secular saint.
Jo bichude hain piyare se bhatakte dar badar phirte hamara यार है हम में हमन को इंतजारी क्या कबीरा इश्क का माता ओ कबीरा इश्क का माता दुई को दूर कर दिल से जो चलना राह नाजुक है।
भीमराव स्पेंट हिज चाइल्डहुड एट दापोली।
हमन सिर बोझ।
हिज फैमिली शिफ्टेड टू सातारा वेयर ही लॉस्ट हिज मदर।
जो बिछुड़े हैं प्यारे से।
He was thus brought up under the loving care of his paternal aunt Mirabai. It is not difficult to imagine how the young Ambedkar's sensitive mind reacted to the treatment the untouchables were given. In school, the teachers were kind and compassionate. One of the Brahmin teachers was fond of young Bhim and was so impressed by his intellect that he lent his own name to the young student. And thus, Bhimrao Ambedkar became Bhimrao Ambedkar. Nevertheless, caste discrimination was galore. The barber would not touch Bhim's hair for fear of being polluted. It was his sister who trimmed his hair. Bhim and his brother were made to sit outside the class on gunny cloth, for they felt their touch would pollute the other high caste students and the teachers. Bhim could not drink water from the common pitcher. Learning Sanskrit was taboo for the untouchables. The orthodox teachers dared not allow young Bhim to learn the language of the Vedas. Later, in the cosmopolitan Elphinstone School at Bombay too, Bhim had to suppress his fervent desire to study Sanskrit and was forced to take Persian instead. Their woes were endless. Once, when young Bhim and his brother set out to go to a nearby village in a bullock cart, the carriage owner threw them out on learning they were untouchables. On the way, no Savarna would serve them water to quench their thirst. "Go away, go away," people said, and asked them to drink from a filthy wayside pool. Despite the congested accommodation Ambedkar's family had in Bombay, first in Dabak Chawl and then in the Bombay Improvement Trust Chawl, surrounded by the labor area and the underworld, young Bhim pursued his studies diligently, often sleeping in the company of goats, reading in public parks and under street lamps. Once, when Bhimrao was asked by the teacher to solve an example on the board, the panic-stricken Savarna boys scrambled first to remove their tiffin boxes from behind the blackboard to prevent them from being polluted. Turn in any direction you like. Caste is the monster that crosses your path. You cannot have political reforms unless you kill this monster. Ambedkar was married immediately after his success in the matriculation examination in the Baikala public vegetable market. The age of the groom, 17 years, and the bride Ramai, 9 years. Education continued. After graduation, he served the progressive-minded Maharaja of Baroda, Sayajirao Gaikwad, who provided Ambedkar with a scholarship to go abroad. Before he set sail, Ambedkar lost his father. Then on to the United States of America. the land of liberty and equality, the land of Thomas Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln, to pursue higher studies. Columbia University, New York. To begin with, he stayed at the Hartley Hall, the university dormitory, but the food did not suit him, and so he shifted to the Cosmopolitan Club, 114th Street, where most Indian students stayed. And then at the Livingston Hall dormitory, with a kind and very helpful Parsi friend and admirer, Naval Bhatena. Political science, moral philosophy, anthropology, sociology, and economics were his subjects of interest in Columbia, where he could quench his thirst for knowledge in the libraries rich with books. Ambedkar had a passion for knowledge and an obsession with books. Above all, he knew he must study hard to fight his battles back at home. He drove himself to keep a punishing schedule, foregoing all the comforts, spending all of his time in libraries burning the midnight oil. Often he sustained himself on a loaf of bread and a cup of coffee. He had to save a considerable amount from his paltry scholarship to remit money to his family in India. Eleanor Zelliot, a noted scholar of Ambedkar's writings and Dalit literature, says,
1913-1916 were Columbia's glory days. It was the most distinguished center of learning, I think, in America. He studied with many distinguished teachers. Perhaps the most famous is John Dewey, America's best-known educator. Pragmatic, in love with democracy, a world traveler, Ambedkar remembered John Dewey all his life, and at the end of his life, used to imitate his teaching style. He even quoted Dewey. Dewey said, every society gets encumbered with what is trivial, with dead wood from the past, with what is perverse. Society must not conserve everything, but only the things that make for a better future. And that was Dr. Ambedkar's philosophy. He studied with Edwin Seligman, a very distinguished economist and a very kind man. And what did he get in America? What did he learn from being in New York? I think he learned to have faith in democracy. New York was growing, New York was exciting, New York was dangerous. New York had Italians and Irish, and the American Negro, as it was called then, was coming up into this area. Ambedkar saw many, many peoples living together and a democracy that worked. Not only was he taught that by John Dewey, but I think he could see it in the structure of New York itself, a faith in democracy that never left him. I think he learned about race here. I think he could see that the black people, the Negro people, as they were called at that time, the people of color, were separate, had a separate church. The Abyssinian Baptist Church, a pure black church, is very near here. And he alone, of all the untouchable leaders, said, we are not a separate race. We are not a separate race. We must be treated distinctly in order to join all other Indians. And I think that fear of being thought to be permanently separate may have come from his New York experience.
Professor Ainslie T. Embry, Columbia University, an Indologist of repute, says,
when Ambedkar came to Columbia in the years before the First World War, the dominant intellectual influence here was represented by John Dewey. John Dewey's ideas in education were extraordinarily influential. He regarded education as basically concerned with creating democracy. He was very strongly against the old idea of education as perpetuating tradition. He was convinced that what had gone wrong with Europe was an emphasis on transmitting the past. And his argument was that we should give to children only what will be useful to them, only what will help them lead better lives. So to him, education and democracy were inseparable. Now, along with this was an enormous emphasis on equality. Now, this again is part of the dominant ideas of the United States in those years. There was a great deal of anti-European feeling. And it's interesting in some of Medgar's early writings, his academic writings.
In 1915, Ambedkar was awarded a master's degree for his thesis, Ancient Indian Commerce. His paper, Castes in India, was acknowledged as the first scientific analysis of the barbaric social structure in India, the first salvo in a terrible war he waged throughout his life. Soon after this, he was awarded the Doctor of Philosophy degree for his thesis, The Evolution of Provincial Finance in British India. From USA to the London School of Economics for advanced studies and also putting in terms at Gray's Inn for law. But his scholarship remuneration had run out. Despite his efforts, Ambedkar had to go back and serve Baroda State on the insistence of the state's Diwan. While in Baroda, Ambedkar had his first whiff of how even a superior officer, if he is an untouchable, is treated by the lowliest, a sepoy. This learned man, who had earned a doctorate from an American university, could not secure decent accommodation. He was literally thrown out of hotels and even from a Parsi guest house. So humiliating was the treatment meted out by the high caste staff to this senior official of the Baroda state, that Ambedkar returned to Bombay disgusted. And thus ordained Mannu, an untouchable, howsoever old and venerated he is lower in stature than the lowest of the caste Hindus, men, women, and infants. A brief stint as a lecturer in Bombay's Sydenham College, and then this unusual young man of learning who had launched a crusade against the system of caste, attracted the attention of Shahu Maharaj of Kolhapur, himself a reformist prince who worked hard to break the hold of Brahmin priests on society and emancipate the downtrodden. It was at this juncture in 1920 that Dr. Ambedkar, under the patronage of Shahu Maharaj, launched a fortnightly to articulate the anguish of his depressed community. The journal was appropriately titled Mookanayak, the Dumb Hero. After all, Dr. Ambedkar was the greatest follower of Mahatma Jyotiba Phule, that outstanding man who championed the cause of women and the depressed in the 19th century. Soon, the prince offered him a scholarship to complete his discontinued studies in London, and Dr. Ambedkar set sail for England in July 1920. While resuming terms at the London School of Economics and Gray's Inn, Ambedkar turned his full attention to general reading, giving a free rein to his avarice for knowledge and books. The British Museum Library, the famous repository of knowledge for centuries, to which many a great man of learning had made a pilgrimage seeking enlightenment, was Dr. Ambedkar's favorite haunt. Ambedkar virtually starved himself to buy books. In any case, his funds did not amount to much, £8 a month. He lived frugally, hardly spending anything on clothes or transport. He often trudged on foot to different libraries to save money. He completed 2 theses for the London University: Imperial Finance in the Provinces of British India and The Problem of the Rupee. In London, Dr. Ambedkar simultaneously put in terms at the famous Gray's Inn. A man of versatile intellect, Dr. Ambedkar, even as he completed his thesis at the university, was called at the bar, the highest honor any person of his background had achieved till then. And although fully immersed in this academic pursuit, Dr. Ambedkar never for a moment could forget his people back at home. The inhuman plight of the untouchables was his unending obsession, and he frequently wrote to his wife asking anxious queries. Dear Ramu, I am writing this letter from a distance of 3,000 miles. I know my absence has thrown a very large responsibility on you, but I am sure you will bear it with fortitude. Be sure that our children study hard. Ambedkar returned home in April 1923, before the degree of Doctor of Science was awarded to him. A great reception awaited the young man. From then on, while practicing law in the Bombay High Court, he plunged headlong into his life's mission to uplift the untouchables, to educate them. To achieve these goals, his first organizational attempt was the establishment of the Bahishkrita Hitkarini Sabha, an organization for the welfare of outcasts. The first major battle was over the Savdar water tank at Mahad in Colaba district, an obscure place. That was a pioneering struggle which rocked the foundations of the caste-ridden society and blazed a trail in the social history of India. The beautiful freshwater tank, right in the midst of the town, was open to all. Savarna Hindus, Christians, Muslims, Europeans, cattle, dogs and birds could freely draw water from this tank, except the untouchables, the Shudras, the low-caste Hindus, who worshipped the same gods as the Savarna Hindus did. By a Bombay Legislative Council resolution of 1923, the tanks should be open to all. But it was not so. A conference of untouchables was held at Mahad on 18th and 20th March 1927, which heralded the beginning of the struggle. The untouchables, half-clad men and women, young and old, congregated at Mahad, walking through the streets of the town, shouting slogans in praise of Shivaji and Dr. Ambedkar. Finally, they gathered at the conference, even as tension gripped the town. On the second day, the conference spontaneously decided that its president, Dr. Ambedkar, should lead a procession of untouchables to drink water from the prohibited tank. Subedar Raghunath More, a retired army man who had participated in the actual struggle, says,
"Sabha zali, nantar ami sagle jane sayakle jane to paach paach saat saat jane ki file lagun pura kranti sambhav saya pare kiti 25,000 lok hote ho kay bagayla loko jevan kele
ta. We went in a disciplined procession, nearly 25,000 of us in rows of four. We walked silently through the streets and then to the brink of the tank, Baba Sahib leading us. As thousands of eyes watched, Dr. Ambedkar touched the water.
बाबांच्या बरोबर आम्ही तळ्यावर गेला आणि तळ्याचं पाणी बाबा शिरले तर एवढ्यात गोंधळ तिकडे स्वर्ण हिंदूंनी त्यांचे जे गडी होते खुद्द स्वर्णबाई ब्राह्मण कोणता आलेला नाही पुढे
मोरे सेज मराठी लोक. That sparked off a violent reaction among the caste Hindus. The tank is polluted. Now they will pollute the temple of Lord Vireshwara, they shouted, and attacked the culprits, the untouchables, with sticks and stones. Several were injured.
आणि आमच्या वडवली गावचा फौजदार बाळू म्हणून त्याच होतो चांगला चाडा मोठा अगदी त्याला आणि चांबार खिंडचा एक त्या 5-6 जणांना मार लागला होता.
Following the violence, the conference refrained from further physical confrontation and civil disobedience and decided to secure their rights through the court. The next day, the Brahmin priests of Mahad purified the tank in a religious ritual. This act wounded Dr. Ambedkar deeply, and they decided to take the struggle further. It was after this struggle that Ambedkar started another fortnightly journal from Bombay, Bahiskrita Bharat. It was part of the Mahad campaign that on December 25th the same year, under the leadership of Dr. Ambedkar, the second conference at the same spot ceremoniously burnt the Manusmriti. I may be hard on Mannu, but I am sure my force is not strong enough to kill his ghost. He lives like a disembodied spirit and is appealed to, and I am afraid will yet live long. The growth of the caste system is too gigantic a task to be achieved by the power or cunning of an individual or of a class. Moving the historic resolution that rocked the Hindu orthodoxy, Dr. Ambedkar compared the event to the French Revolution. The veteran Tarkatirth, Lakshman Shastri Joshi, says,
"When he burned Manusmriti, I met him in Mumbai, Bombay, in his house, Dadar. I told him, you burn Manusmriti, but by burning everything is not negated. Something permanently positive remains in spite of burning Manusmriti." He said, "I believe that Manusmriti must contain so many good thoughts. I don't say that everything is condemnable." He was very clear about it. He was not confused at all.
The crusade continued. Dr. Ambedkar had lit the torch of consciousness. The untouchables all over Maharashtra and the country had begun to galvanize. In 1926, he was nominated by the governor to the Bombay Legislative Council. As a conscientious legislator, Ambedkar applied his erudition and legal knowledge to champion the causes of the lowly and the poor. The Mahar Vatan Bill, seeking to free the untouchables from village bondage, women's emancipation, education of the poor, prohibition. No subject which touched the lives of the downtrodden and the weaker sections escaped Dr. Ambedkar's scrutiny. He became the acting professor of Government Law College. His fame began to spread far and wide. Young intellectuals from the depressed classes began gathering around him. Dr. Ambedkar was called upon to give evidence before the Simon Commission. His deposition evoked a furor and consternation in religious and political circles. We claim that we must be treated as a distinct, independent minority. We claim reserved seats if accompanied by adult franchise. And if there is no adult franchise, we ask for separate electorates. The movement to force entry into temples was an expression of this reformist inclination. The 5-year-long Satyagraha at the famous Kalaram temple of Nashik, which began in 1930, was a test case. The temple of Lord Rama at Nashik is an ancient place of pilgrimage, where holy Kumbh Melas are held every 12 years. But for the untouchables, it was impossible to set their eyes on the idol of Lord Rama. The depressed classes of Nashik formed a Satyagraha committee under the leadership of Bhaurao Gaikwad to participate in the struggle under the guidance of Dr. Ambedkar.
म्हणजे जवळजवळ 15,000 लोक या सत्याग्रहाला सामील झाले. लोक म्हणजे मुलं, स्त्रिया, पुरुष, म्हातारे, वारकरी, त्याच्यानंतर बैरागी मोठा जयघोष करीत चाललेले होते आणि लोकांच्या अंगामध्ये इतका संचारलं होतं सत्याग्रहाचं वारं की ते अतिशय आनंदानं आम्हाला आताही कुठे पकडण्याचा हरकत नाही पण बाबासाहेबांनी सुरू केलेला सत्याग्रह अत्यंत महत्त्वाचा आहे आणि आम्हाला आमचे हक्क बाबासाहेब म्हणतात त्याप्रमाणे मिळालेच पाहिजे असं सगळ्यांचं म्हणणं आणि गाडी पडत चालली जयघोष करत चालले लष्करी बाण पहिल्यांदा होता लष्करी पद्धतीचा त्याच्यानंतर मग बालवीराचं पथक होतं.
One of the satyagrahis in the forefront, Shantabai Dani, says, men, women and children, bairagis and sannyasis, inspired by Dr. Ambedkar, marched on, singing songs and joyful religious dhuns. They were ready to sacrifice their lives to earn their rights. Then suddenly, stones began showering on the satyagrahis. Tension mounted in the city. The untouchables decided to lay siege to the temple. The priests closed the gates and Lord Rama became inaccessible not only to the Shudras but also to the high castes. The siege continued. As the birth anniversary of Lord Rama drew near, a compromise was reached. The ritual Ram Rath on that day would be pulled both by the Savarnas and the untouchables.
रथ ओढायला सुरू झाले तरी अर्धे लोक तिकडे अर्धे आमचे एका दुसरीला लागले परंतु त्या लोकांच्या मनातूनच नव्हतं का आम्ही लोकांनी रथ ओढावा.
The Satyagrahis recalled the drama even today. It appeared that the Savarnas had no intention of allowing us to touch the divine chariot. They started throwing stones. I was hit by a stone and started bleeding profusely. But I would not leave the procession. The prolonged Satyagraha evoked retribution against the untouchables all over. But the Satyagrahis were undeterred. the temple remained closed for a whole year, and the agitation continued till the end of 1935. Ambedkar found all doors of the Hindu religion closed to the untouchables. He soon lost interest in the temple entry movement. He told his people, "The object of the temple entry movement is good, but you should care more for material good than for spiritual food." One steadfast supporter of Dr. Ambedkar's reform movement was the veteran freedom fighter Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, interned in Ratnagiri. Savarkar was against caste divisions and worked for uplifting the depressed castes and removing untouchability. He wanted to invite Dr. Ambedkar to inaugurate an all-caste temple he built in Ratnagiri. Due to his previous engagements, Dr. Ambedkar could not make it. Dr. Ambedkar was invited to the Roundtable Conference in London in September 1930 as a representative of the depressed classes. The objective of the conference, held at the historic St. James Palace, was to frame a constitution for India by taking into account the views of various sections of people. But Ambedkar's willingness to represent his people at the conference aggravated the resentment of the Indian National Congress, which had boycotted the Simon Commission and also the conference. All those who associated with the conference were roundly condemned and accused as lackeys of the British by the congressmen. From then, Dr. Ambedkar, in the eyes of the Congress, carried the foul stigma of being a stooge of the British. And yet, at the conference, his fierce and uncompromising championship of the Indian national interests caused surprise at home and consternation in ruling quarters. Dr. Ambedkar pleaded at the conference that the bureaucratic form of government in India should be replaced by a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And yet, he insisted, in such a setup, power should not go unchallenged into the hands of the tyrannical majority. The depressed classes must have their just share. They must have adequate safeguards. On this, there could be no compromise. In all the three rounds of the Roundtable Conference, in the plenary sessions, in committee and in subcommittee meetings, Dr. Ambedkar used all his erudition and skill to champion two causes: India's freedom and safety, and the protection of the depressed in a free and democratic India. While in London for the Roundtable Conference, Dr. Ambedkar stayed at different places, but maintained steady communication with his movement and followers through a flood of letters. His performance at the Roundtable Conference made a deep impact on the intellectual and the political circles in England. Nobody could now ignore Ambedkar. Ambedkar's relentless espousal of the cause of the untouchables did have some effect. Mahatma Gandhi, who sincerely believed that it was not in the interest of the scheduled castes to stray away from the Indian political mainstream, was perturbed. He invited Dr. Ambedkar for a discussion to Mani Bhavan in Bombay. Gandhiji said, "It is really surprising that men like you are opposed to me and to the Congress. We are not prepared to have faith in great leaders and Mahatmas. Let me be brutally frank about it. History tells us that Mahatmas, like fleeting phantoms, raise dust, but raise no level. Why should the Congress oppose our movement and dub me a traitor?" "Gandhiji, I have no homeland," Gandhiji replied. "You have got a homeland. I know you're a patriot of sterling worth. How can I call this land my own homeland? And this religion my own, wherein we are treated worse than cats and dogs? I am against political separation of the untouchables from the Hindus. That would be absolutely suicidal," said Gandhiji. That was the first crossing of swords between Gandhi, the Mahatma, and Ambedkar, the savior of the untouchables. And when the British Prime Minister declared the communal award, granting separate electorates to the untouchables, Mahatma Gandhi went on a fast unto death. Ambedkar thundered, "There have been many Mahatmas in India whose sole object was to remove untouchability, but every one of them has failed. Mahatmas have come and Mahatmas have gone, but the untouchables have remained the untouchables." Tension heightened as Gandhiji's health deteriorated. "My life or separate electorates for the untouchables," threatened the Mahatma. So overbearing was the pressure that Dr. Ambedkar had to give in. A compromise was reached. Instead of separate electorates, the concept of reserved constituencies was accepted. And then the famous Pune Pact was signed. Gandhiji ended his long fast. The confrontation symbolized the historic clash between the differing socio-political perspectives of the two great men. The nation heaved a sigh of relief, but the untouchables had lost a battle. "At present, I am the most hated man in Hindu India. I am represented as a traitor. I am denounced as the enemy of the Hindus. I am cursed as a destroyer of Hinduism and branded as the greatest enemy of the country. But believe me when I say that when after some days the dust settles down and a review of the proceedings of the roundtable conference is dispassionately taken by future historians, the future generations of Hindus will acclaim my services to the nation." Meanwhile, Dr. Ambedkar realized his private dream, which every scholar and lover of books nurses, to build a house, to have one's own private library. Rajgriha in Dadar, Bombay. Mr. S.S. Rege, the famous librarian of Siddharth College, tells a story about a priest who went to persuade Ambedkar on how his own religion offered true salvation.
Now there, Dr. Ambedkar was listening to him very quietly. And after that, he quietly asked him, "What Bible do you use for your prayers?" Now this priest was surprised. He didn't know what this question was. He said, "What Bible?" I said, "The Holy Bible." "Yes, yes, I know the Holy Bible, but which version do you use?" And when he said this version, he just called me and he said, "Rege, you get all those copies of Bible which you have." And I brought 18 copies of Bible, placed them before the priest. And he said, "Look, this is King James version, this is Elizabeth version, this is this version." Now, this priest was flabbergasted to say that this fellow has number of copies of different types of Bible.
Dr. Ambedkar supervised the designing of the house personally with a view to accommodate his vast and unique collection of books, his principal passion. Books he starved himself to buy. Here it was in 1935 that his devoted companion of many years, Ramabai, passed away, leaving a vacuum in Dr. Ambedkar's life. For a few days, Dr. Ambedkar went into deep mourning and secluded himself from the world. At the historic conference of the depressed classes at Yola in October 1935, he gave vent to his frustration and for the first time publicly expressed his desire to leave the Hindu fold. He told the Yola gathering, "Unfortunately, I am born a Hindu untouchable. I solemnly assure you that I will not die a Hindu." So momentous was this announcement that it took the Indian society by storm. He was elected to the Bombay Legislative Assembly in the first general elections of 1935 as an independent Labour Party candidate. This party, newly formed by him, won 17 seats. He gave deep thought to the plight of the working class, even as he organized workers' trade unions. He spoke on the finances of the state and the nation. Agrarian problems, such as the consolidation of small holdings, attracted his studied comments. Mr. P.T. Borade, Dr. Ambedkar's close associate, says,
Baba Sahib Ambedkar, as a matter of fact, wanted all injustices and exploitations existing in India be ended. And three types of exploitations were there so far when he has started the movement. One, what is known to be Vatandari or Maharvat Kamgars or Vatandars. Second, the halal system means plow, attached to the plow system. And thirdly, Khoti system, which were the three together. And lastly, general agricultural movement and scavengers. The halais means one who was attached to a plow. That man was enforced to work throughout his family. And there was no independence for that. And the lands were so, they were sold along with the land. And thus, that was the agricultural serfdom must be ended. Baba Sahib Ambedkar therefore started a movement along with Ghulam Maharaj and others when many people were assaulted and at the same time they were detained. And that particular system was so existing that along with Khoti system, this was also ended in
1938.
Mr. P.J. Roham, Ambedkar's associate and a member of the assembly, says, Dr. Ambedkar's championship of birth control in those days shows how far ahead of his time he was. Lord Bottomley, member of the Parliamentary Committee visiting India, says,
when I went to India in 46, he was a member of the Viceroy's Council and responsible for industrial matters. I was the only trade unionist on the parliamentary mission from this country. It was natural that I would seek him out to talk about industry and related matters. I asked him about the trade unions, and he said he was keen to get trade unions established and was encouraging employers to recognise trade unions. He seemed very keen on that. He also told me he wanted to establish a minimum wage for workers. If I tell you that it was many years later that the British Labour Party embarked upon such a scheme, you'll see how advanced he was and his thoughts. In addition to talking about trade unions, we talked about industrial matters generally, and arising from that he said to me that it was his desire, he'd been reading about the social reforms in Britain as a result of the new Labour government, and he said he wanted to bring about social services in India following the pattern that was being established in Britain.
Baba Sahib Ambedkar introduced the Labour Welfare Acts, like Payment of Wages Act. Then also for the employment is concerned, he established employment exchange. Exchanges today, what we find for the employment is concerned, then education, housing, and also wages adequate to the standard of living.
Through the hustle and bustle of his busy public life, the scholar and the public-spirited man in him produced several monumental works. Among those particularly acknowledged for his erudition and referred worldwide in academic communities were his works Who Were Shudras, The Untouchables, and Pakistan or Partition of India. He specifically took time off to go to a secluded place in Ahmednagar to do research and write this book. Ambedkar was quite incisive in his views on Pakistan. The case made by Ambedkar was so formidable that hardly any matching retort came out. The book created a furor. Burying Pakistan is not the same thing as burying the ghost of Pakistan. So long as the hostility to one central government of India, which is the ideology underlying Pakistan, persists, the ghost of Pakistan will be there, casting its ominous shadow upon the political future of India. Education, in his view, was the major weapon to fight social evils. His long-cherished dream was fulfilled when he founded the People's Education Society and started Siddharth College at Bombay in June 1946 and later the Milind Mahavidyalay, Aurangabad. Later, Dr. Ambedkar donated his vast collection of books to the Siddharth College Library. The huge library testifies to his wide range of reading. Mr. Ghanashyam Talwatkar, his associate in the field of education, says,
"The object of the People's Education Society, founded by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, is not only to give education, but to give education in such a manner that it should promote intellectual, cultural, and social democracy. And with this context, the law started is all institutions, and the benefit of these institutions were given to all students coming from various caste, creed, and community. Even in Siddharth College, or for that matter, the Milind Mahavidyalaya, you find that hundreds of people belonging to different castes, different layer of community, they have taken the advantage of the education and they have elevated their lives in a much better way. And it is, as a matter of fact, it is a nation-building work."
He took a personal interest in designing and constructing the building and campus of the Milind Mahavidyalay. Greater challenges were awaiting Dr. Ambedkar. He had a mission to fulfill. Destiny awaited him in Delhi. In July 1942, Dr. Ambedkar was invited to join the Viceroy's Executive Council as a Labour member. Dr. Ambedkar was elected to the Constituent Assembly of India in October 1946. His outstanding moment came when he was elected and made chairman of the committee to draft the constitution.
We were knowing each other almost for 1 year before we got married. On the 15th of April 1948, Dr. Ambedkar had taken over law ministry since 1947 when we met. And after my marriage, I was very closely watching him work on the constitution. He was given the position as chairman of drafting committee of the constitution. And as a very important position as a chairman, he had to work very hard to see that all schedules and articles in the constitution are discussed properly and all the members in the parliament know what they are doing. So his schedule for almost 16 to 18 months was very tight.
It was, however, ironic that due to want of backing in the Bombay Legislative Assembly, he had to be elected to the Constituent Assembly on the backing of the scheduled caste members of the Bengal Assembly. I know that today we are divided politically, socially, and economically. We are in warring camps, and I am probably the leader of one of the warring camps. But with all this, I am convinced that given time and circumstances, nothing in the world will prevent this country from becoming one. And with all our castes and creeds, I have not the slightest hesitation in saying that we shall in some form be a united people. Thus it was that on August 15th, 1947, India met her destiny and became a free nation in the world. Dr. Ambedkar, besides becoming the law minister in the interim government of Free India, was ordained to become the principal architect of the Constitution of India. The happiest person was Mahatma Gandhi. "It was a proud moment for India," he told Ambedkar himself, "that the former downtrodden had become the lawmaker of Free India." Ambedkar's extensive knowledge of world history, his profound commitment to the universal democratic principles, and concern for safeguarding the human and political rights of the minorities went into the monumental work of drafting the document. His reply in the House on the prolonged discussion of the draft is considered among the remarkable speeches in India's parliamentary history. When the Constituent Assembly, in the name of the people of India, adopted the Constitution with its 395 articles and 8 schedules on November 26, 1949, no less than Dr. Rajendra Prasad, President of the Constituent Assembly, and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Prime Minister of the interim government, paid glowing tributes to Dr. Ambedkar. Mrs. Mai Sahib Ambedkar says,
"In 1951, in the Indian Parliament, a bill was introduced, which is famous now and well known by name Hindu Code Bill. And Dr. Ambedkar, being a law minister, he had to pilot the bill. And Hindu Code Bill, in short, is meant for emancipation of women from the slavery of Hindu society. And as such, she had great attachment and devotion to this bill. And he worked hard to see that it passes through during his tenure as a law minister. But suddenly there was an issue of elections in 1951. And somebody told Jawaharlal Nehru that if this bill goes through, the orthodox society in the Hindu society would not vote for the Congress and you will not return to power. So Jawaharlal Nehru was taken up by fear, and he told Dr. Ambedkar to stop the work of Hindu Code Bill there and then, and he said, we will introduce this bill in our next session of the parliament after election. As I said, Dr. Ambedkar was so attached and devoted and dedicated to this bill because it concerned the women and their problem, and particularly he was giving an equal share to girls along with the boys in the estate and personal family matters in the house. So Dr. Ambedkar was very much attached and devoted to this bill, and he had often told me and many people that constitution is nothing compared to this Hindu Code Bill, and I must see that it goes through while I am law minister and in this very session of the parliament."
That was the signal for another virulent attack on Dr. Ambedkar from Hindu orthodox quarters. Most progressive sections supported the measures. Ambedkar's view was that the bill codified and modified only certain sections of the Hindu law. The bill was essential for the unity of the Hindu society and the Indian nation as well. A disgusted Dr. Ambedkar finally resigned from the cabinet. "I hate injustice, tyranny, pompousness and humbug, and my hatred embraces all those who are guilty of them. I want to tell my critics that I regard my feelings of hatred as a real force. They are the reflex of the love I bear for the cause I believe in, and I am in no way ashamed of it." Like all great men of the masses, always surrounded by people, Dr. Ambedkar sometimes found himself utterly lonely. This feeling of loneliness perhaps found expression when he suddenly started painting and learning the violin while in his 50s.
"Rajani amha dogha bandhu na doctor jagade andla ani amche olak karun dile to doctor bolle aho tumhala ek violin wala ane sangitle dogha kashala andle."
The Sate brothers, who taught him to play the violin, say, "It was an honor to teach this great man. He already knew how to handle the bow and the instrument. Being a methodical person, He asked for a standard book on the violin. We gave him one. He read the book through the night and asked for a fresh edition of the book. We were surprised.
Now, the violin, how to master it. I think you would say, Lahan, I'm going to post a photo. Can you know me, Jana Dilla? And there are three Watson kind. Paila Parabasan, she would have Paraboran Watson. And the Sri Shami Gilor Richard Kikai to me, Mala Pustak Dilla, the edition kit with Dilly. I'll be good edition book it. To me, out with the Shaishi edition of Maladili. You would have balloon Tamlene, Monalikao. मराठी देख तरी पुस्तक असं आहे का की ज्याच्यात दोनच्या एडिशन निघायच्या पुढे काही निघतात असो नंतर म्हणाले की आता काय करायचं तुम्ही आम्ही त्याला व्हायलिन कसं धरायचं कसं शिकवायचं अहो म्हणले मी इंग्लंड अमेरिकेत व्हायलिन पाहिलेलं आहे मी बरोबर धरतो मग त्याने ते धरलं बरोबर
ही वॉज व्हेरी पर्टिक्युलर अबाउट हिज क्लोथ ही वॉन्टेड व्हेरी स्पिक अँड स्पॅन डिझाईन व्हेरी वेल फिटिंग सूट्स अँड इज पर्टिक्युलर अबाउट कलर्स ऑल्सो He had a tailor, a Mohammedan man, who used to design his clothes and see to that that they fitted well. One particular thing about this tailor, he used to design and stitch clothes for the Viceroy and the Commander-in-Chief of the British days.
Three ideals that he mentioned about were the Karna, Napoleon and Churchill. Now, Churchill and Napoleon, we may say, one of his contemporaries in a way. But about Karna, his father had instilled in his mind that here was a person who was all the way derided by people because he was the Sutaputra. But by devotion, by persistence, by penance in a way can say, he concentrated himself on archery and earned the kundalas, kavacha kundalas from the sun. Now here that his father had told me that you should keep this ideal before you. Never shirk, never be afraid, go ahead.
Ambedkar, in 1935, he had made a pledge that he would not die a Hindu. 20 years had passed. The obduracy of the Hindu society had frustrated him. His health was failing. It was time to fulfill the pledge. His grandson, Prakash Ambedkar, says,
The reconstruction of the society, he said, has to be based on two aspects. One is the social aspect and the other is the religious aspect. He said, while taking social aspect, we have to take the linguistic, regionalistic, and his culturalistic view into consideration. In India, he said that every community that exists is at crossroads with each other. And he said where the communities are at crossroads with each other, they have their different perspectives and they have their different ideas before them which clashes against each other. And these clashes have divided the masses and the communities in India. What he emphasized was that India will consist of an heterogeneous mass. He wanted it to be converted into an homogeneous mass of state. Because he said unless India becomes an homogeneous state, it can't remain united. The second aspect that I was dealing was with religion. In India, the religion that exists and which formed the majority part, the Hindu religion as they say it, has an inbuilt system of inequality. He tried to reform it by reforming the principle of the Hindu tenements. But when he failed and the masses in India didn't respond to it, he went upon the next path which was left open to him. That is to renounce the Hindu religion and to accept Buddhist as a new religion and forming the Buddhist principles as the basis for the homogeneous state in India. At least a way has been set up by him to form a new homogeneous part in India.
I prefer Buddhism because it teaches prajna or understanding as against superstition and supernaturalism, Karuna or love, and Samta or equality.
Babasaheb tharavlo hota ki ani jahiri karun takla hota ki tyanchi diksha Mumbai la hoil. Parantu mala vatat hota ki Mumbai bharatacha eka bajula padta ani Nagpur he madhyavarti ahe. Nagpur madhe janta pushkashi janta bauddha dharmakade lavkar diksha ghyachi tayarit ahet. आणि या दृष्टीनं आम्ही बाबासाहेबांनी जी संस्था काढली होती भारतीय बौद्धजन समिती ती चालवत होतो त्यांचं प्रेस स्टेटमेंट
मदनराव गोडबोले सेज
त्यांना पत्र लिहिलं
आणि वी पर्सुएडेड डॉक्टर आंबेडकर टू होल्ड द ग्रँड दीक्षा सेरेमनी इन नागपूर सिन्स इट वॉज अ सेंट्रल प्लेस and the ancient capital of the Naga kings. We also told him that the 14th of October was the most auspicious day for the ceremony because that, according to the English calendar, was Lord Buddha's Mahaparinirvan day.
त्याची सुरुवात मात्र 13 लाच झाली आणि ते कारण की त्याचा संबंध भगवान बुद्धाच्या महापरिनिर्वाणच्या दिवसाशी आहे. भगवान बुद्धाचा महापरिनिर्वाण हे 13 ऑक्टोबरला रात्री झालं इंग्लिश कॅलेंडर प्रमाणे.
14 ऑक्टोबरला ठीक 10 वाजता बाबासाहेब दीक्षा मैदानावर पोहोचले. 10:30 त्यावेळेस त्यांनी चंद्रमणीजी म्हणजे भारतामध्ये सगळ्यात वयोवृद्ध भिक्षू यांची निवड धर्मदीक्षकता केली होती.
सदानंद फुलझाले सेज
त्यांच्या हस्ते धर्मदीक्षा.
इट वॉज अ ग्रँड सेरेमनी. डॉक्टर आंबेडकर अराइव्ड ऑन द हाई डायस अलॉंग विथ हिज वाइफ.
नेते मंडळी
He first bowed to the image of Lord Buddha and took Diksha. Dr. Ambedkar then turned to the large gathering of people before him. He told them, I have taken Diksha of Lord Buddha. Whosoever wants to follow me along the path of Buddha should stand and recite the oath. The entire mass of people stood up voluntarily and recited the oath after Dr. Ambedkar in a spirited chorus. It is very rarely that a man witnesses such a grand event in his life.
तुम माझ्या समोर उभे व्हा आणि स्वतः धर्मदीक्षा घ्या.
पाणाते पाता वेदमनी शिक्षा पदम समारयामि.
Dr. Ambedkar's embracing Buddhism was an epoch-making event. It shook the Hindu society to its very foundations. Nearly a million untouchables accompanied Dr. Ambedkar on his new path. But more important than the numbers, the grand Diksha ceremony symbolized the denouncement of the Hindu caste system and the pernicious practice of untouchability.
His personal secretary Nanakchand Rattu says,
On the night of 5th December at about 11:30, when I took leave of him to go home, I was just approaching the main gate, then the servant came running that I was called back by Babasaheb. I parked my bicycle outside, I went inside and asked Babasaheb what is the matter. He said, before going you do one thing, place that introduction and preface to the book Buddha and Dhamma on his table. Then he had also dictated to me one letter addressed to Atre and Joshi of Samyukta Party Bombay regarding formation of the Republican Party of India. Then another letter he had addressed to the Burma government, to the Sasana, Burma Sasana, to propagate Buddhism and how to finance it. Then early in the morning, the servant and the driver, they came to my place, knocked the door. As soon as I opened, I was surprised to see their faces. I took it that something must have happened. I immediately inquired, is Babasaheb all right? But they did not have, they only said their names are bad. Sent them to call you. So immediately I started, read 26th early road. Mr. Ambedkar was sitting in the veranda waiting for me. Immediately, I got out of the car. He took me inside and told me that Baba Sahab has left us. Taking courage, I immediately ran to the room where I had left Baba Sahab the previous night. I called Baba Sahab, Baba Sahab.
thus ended on December 6, 1956, the great journey of one of the tallest sons of India.
जो बिछुड़े हैं प्यारे से भटकते दर बदर फिर
A fierce social rebel and yet a compassionate reformist. A proud nationalist who would not compromise on the rights of the downtrodden. An iconoclast who believed in the necessity of religion. A champion of women and the minorities. The last outstanding leader in the glorious chain of social reformers Maharashtra has produced, Ranade, Phule, Agarkar and Ambedkar. The great son of India who gave self-respect and political rights to the millions of untouchables of India.
जो बिछुड़े हैं प्यारे
विदाउट मी अ परसुएडिंग पीपल टू अडॉप्ट द प्रिंसिपल इज बाय परसुएशन बाय मॉरल टीचिंग बाय लव ही वांट्स टू कॉन्कर हिज अपोनेंट्स बाय इनकल्केटिंग इन देम द डॉक्ट्रिन So love can conquer anything, and not power. That's where the fundamental difference lies. That the Buddha would not allow violence, and the communists do. No doubt, the communists get quick results, because when you adopt the means of annihilating him, he does not remain to oppose you. You go on with your ideology. You go on with your ways of doing things. The Buddha's way, they said, is a long way. Perhaps some people may say, a tedious way. But I have no doubt about it, that it is the surest way.